God's just absolutely amazing. That's all I can tell you. You know, I want to start off, what's so amazing about the Word of God is that it's better than the Super Doppler radar, should I say. It's more accurate than Margaret Orr, right? I mean, Edward Casey, those guys that predict the future, and they ain't got a thing on God's Word.
Amen.
You know, and I done had three messages this week. You know, the first two the Lord threw out the window. Friday morning, I got up early and went and got in the house. Went and sat down, opened my Bible. I'm like, all right, Lord, you know, what you want to do? What you want to talk about? You know, and me, myself, desperately needing to hear from God, hear a word from God. So all of a sudden, you know, the Lord started speaking to me, and, you know, he just said, well, where you at? No, he said, well, where I'm at? I'm like, where you at? When speaking, where is he at in the times and the seasons that we're living in right now? So instantly, you know, when he had said that, you know, we just came through Passover. And we know that, you know, Passover and we have unleavened bread. It lasts for 7 days, right? Passover and unleavened bread run simultaneously. And then from the 10th to the 17th. And then on the 17th, you know, Jesus arose from the dead. And it began the Feast of First Fruits. So it's called the counting of the Omer from the 17th day all the way 7 sevens, 49 days, the counting of the Omer, all the way to the 50th day, Pentecost, right? So I started thinking, where are you at right now? God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's never changing. And if you want to know what God is thinking about and what God is doing right now, man, watch. This message is going to be absolutely amazing. So I told my wife this morning, and I'm going to show you something that really is going to just blow your mind. But I told her to bring the Hebrew calendar for me today. Don't worry about the boys. Just pay attention. I told her to bring the Hebrew calendar for me today.
Amen.
And I didn't look at it prior to this morning. And oh my, I'm going to show you that in a little bit. So anyway, I started thinking, all right, Lord, you know, where are we at right now? Well, we're between the Feast of First Fruits and Pentecost.
Amen.
And that's what he told me. I'm sitting there and he said, between the Feast of First Fruits and Pentecost, that's where I'm at. I'm like, that's where you're at. And that's where we're at. So instantly, you know, I connected to the Word to find, you know, to start looking back on what was going on. What was going on biblically between the Feast of First Fruits and Pentecost? Because, that's me, just to let you know, between the Feast of First Fruits and Pentecost, today is the 28th day. 7, 14, 21, 28. And this is a Sabbath. So we're 28 days in the Feast of First Fruits.
That's right.
Okay? I don't know why this thing, I'm sorry. So we're 28 days into the Feast of First Fruits. So the message today is between the First Fruits and Pentecost. Now, with having the Word of God, we're able to go back and look and see what was going on then. Because you're going to find out that what was going on then, over and over and over, is exactly what's going on now. Because the Bible says that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's never changing. He gives us the natural things to understand the things of the Spirit. So if you can know where we're at right now, well then, you know where God's at. If you know what God's doing right now, you're going to understand why maybe you're going through the things that you're going through. why things are happening. So in order for us to understand the time that we're in right now, let's go back and look, because God says He declares the end from the beginning.
Right.
He's never changing. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Right? If you want to know what's going to happen in the end, look to the beginning. We're in a season or a cycle. In Leviticus 23, God commanded the children of Israel to keep His feast. Why? Because the feasts speak of Jesus.
Come on.
They speak of Jesus. They tell you the times and seasons that you're living in. Now watch this right here. So, between Passover and Pentecost, we're in the Feast of First Fruits, understanding God in a deeper and more powerful way. That's what I want you to understand today. I want to show you where you're at. I want to show you why you're going through the things that you're going through right now. We get the feast and the festivals in Leviticus 23. Now watch this. So between the Feast of First Fruits and Pentecost, you know, everybody knows what Pentecost is. This is the day the Holy Spirit came down, right? It was given. We're going to get a deeper understanding of Acts chapter 2, way down here, when you have a better understanding of here, and you're going to see that every time it's the exact same thing. Remember the word my mama gave this morning when the Spirit was moving. Watch this. Amazing. God is amazing. So let's see what was going on. We, as a body, we just had the marriage supper. We just came through Passover. I'm going to say it again. We're 28 days into the Feast of First Fruits, looking towards June the 12th, which is Pentecost. Actually, it could range between June the 12th and June the 19th, but I'm not going to get, you know, to, you know, I have the Hebrew calendar here, and we're going to get into that. And on the Hebrew calendar, it says the Pentecost is on June the 12th, Shavuot, Pentecost. Very important day. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So let's see what's going on. Let's look at the church back then to see what was going on back then, to see if it looks like what's happening right now.
Okay.
Watch this. It's good stuff. So let's see. In Exodus chapter 15, Moses is in Egypt. Now this is not the first time we see between Passover and Pentecost, this day. I can actually back you up and bring you to the Tower of Babel. When God came down on the Tower of Babel and tongues were confused, that was on the day of Pentecost. That's why on the day of Pentecost, they began to speak in other languages, where God dispersed the children of Israel back then in Genesis chapter 11. Now, through the Holy Spirit, they began to speak with other tongues, because there was nations that were scattered abroad, and He began to preach the gospel. So where He scattered them on Pentecost back then, He gathered them on Pentecost in Israel. Okay? Same day. But there's another time. Before that, Noah entered the ark on the second month, the 17th day. Wow. That was the Feast of First Fruits. And the ark rested in the second month, the 27th day, 10 days later. That the ark rested 10 days before Pentecost in the Feast of First Fruits. Same time. We can look at what was going on in the Tower of Babel to find out what would be happening now. Confusion, remember, in the Tower of Babel. We can look at the days of Noah when, you know, the Bible says that Noah was a preacher of righteousness, but no one would listen. He's calling people to come into the boat, and finally Noah comes in, you know, and then God closes the door and, you know, destroys everything. So that's the same time as well. But without getting in great detail, I want to go to Moses first, because before they even received the feast of the Lord at Mount Sinai, God tells them to keep the feast of Passover. Remember? So in Egypt, here I'm setting the stage. So God told Moses, on the 10th day of Nisan, take a lamb into the house, keep it for 4 days, bring it outside the door on the 17th and kill it. The 10th through the 17th. That's before Passover is even instituted yet. Moses hadn't made it to the mountain to receive the law. It's not an institution. It's going to be. But this is a picture of how it points to Christ. So on the 10th day, they take a lamb into the house. They bring it outside the door on the 14th, and they kill it. And they put the blood on the lintels. The death angel passes over, right? They leave Egypt on the 14th. They come to the Red Sea. They come out of the God parts it. It says the east wind blew all night. That's the east wind right there. It's the Ruach HaKodesh, it says. It blew all night. The waters parted. And when they, all night, when they came up on the other side, it was early in the morning on the 17th. That's the same time Jesus came out the ground. Same time. So now when they came up out of the Red Sea on the other side, Miriam sings a song of Moses. And that's in Exodus chapter 15. The horse and rider, you know, thrown into the sea, I will sing unto the Lord, for he is triumph glorious, the horse and rider. And she puts on the timbrels and starts dancing. Miriam, this is, you know, Aaron and Moses' sister. She's leading them in worship. Wow. You're going to find out that not many days from then, that she's actually in rebellion.
Wow.
She's in rebellion. Turn me down a little bit. So let's look at what's going on. So the Bible says that the children of Israel was called the church in the wilderness. That's what he says. They were saved by blood. They were baptized unto Moses, and the rock that did follow them was Jesus Christ. They was baptized unto Moses and Jesus in the sea, and the rock that did follow them was Jesus Christ. They drank from that spiritual rock, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, and that rock was Jesus. They were fed with the manna from heaven. God split the rock. That's the church. They were called out of Egypt. That word called out of is ek, which is derived from ekklesia, which where we get the called out ones for the church. We're the church. Yeah. We've been called out of the world, out of the darkness, into his marvelous light. Israel was a picture of the church. Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 6 and 7 that we're to learn from their example.
That's right.
But what are we to learn from them? Paul is telling a church what we need to learn from them.
That's right.
What was their problem? Well, let's go back and look at Moses. So what happened when they came up on the other side of the Red Sea? What was the first thing that happened? Wow, God wiped out Pharaoh's army. Right? They start singing and dancing. Right after the singing and dancing is done, God arms them. Who? What did you say? He arms them.
Go ahead.
Why would God arm them? Because there's fixing to be a battle. They picked up the swords and all the Egyptians' stuff that was washing up on the shore. They were armed by God because a war is coming.
Wow.
You've been battling?
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
You've been battling? Between First Fruits and Pentecost, there's a war. Wow. So now, they armed. And they don't go to battle right away. They go on a 3-day journey. Exodus chapter 16, they go on a 3-day journey to Meribah, where the waters are bitter. Let's see. Let's look at it right here. It says, so here the first thing that happens on the first day of the Feast of First Fruits, they sing the song and all of this kind of stuff. Now they got to go through 49 days to get to Mount Sinai, or Mount Horeb. And here they're armed. So if they're armed, we need to expect the battle. Right? We have to expect the battle. Expect the battle right now. Battle's coming. You're in a fight. Right? There's some people fighting to get here this morning. The enemy wanting to keep you away from being blessed. Watch this. Let's see. It says in Genesis chapter 15, verse 24, they arrive. This is in 15:24. They arrive at Meribah where they start complaining. What was the word that was given this morning?
Complaining.
If you guys wasn't here, my mom, through worshiping at my mom, you know, spirit, she began to give a word about what she sees in the church, and, you know, just God was speaking about, man, stop complaining, and, you know, and all of this kind of stuff. Powerful. I didn't even talk to her. I didn't share the message with her. That's why I told the church, listen to what, I was walking up to my brother, tears running out of my eyes. Oh my God. God was moving so. On. He's still here.
Still here.
Still here. Giving you his message, not mine. So the first thing we see between the Feast of First Fruits and Pentecost is the children of Israel, the called out ones, the church, they begin complaining because they ain't got nothing to drink, right? So God says, all right, Moses, take that tree. That tree we know is, you know, Jesus Christ cast it into the waters, which were bitter, right? And it made it sweet. Well, that's the old covenant. Jesus made, you know, the new covenant, made the old covenant sweet, right? So this is what it's about. So he gives them what they want. During the Feast of First Fruits. The next thing we see in Exodus chapter 16. Oh yeah, I want to tell you another thing. Notice that it's at this time there's an exodus going on. There's a leaving one place and moving to another. Is this not crazy? 2 weeks ago I said it's time to go.
Yeah.
God has to have a place for us.
Wow.
We're in a transition time.
Okay.
Wow. We're growing. Yeah. It's good. The address here is 33 Saddle Up Your Trail. Your tail. Saddle up your tail because we're fixing to move. Why? Because the cloud's moving. We got to go with it.
That's right. Amen.
Watch. It's crazy. You talk about a message. Watch this. It says, what was going on with the called out ones during this time? It was called the Exodus. So in this time, there's a moving or a leaving or a shifting. Right? Look what the next thing. And in Exodus chapter 16, verse 1 and 2. In Exodus chapter 16, verse 1 and 2, we see they murmured and complained, and they wanted to go back to Egypt.
Right.
That's the next thing that happens. Did you bring us out here to kill us?
Stop with that, huh?
The church is complaining. Man, they ain't even a week out yet from being delivered, from being set free, from the death angel passing over, from God parting the Red Sea, seeing miracles that are unbelievable. A week later, they in full rebellion.
Come on now.
Complaining that they have nothing to drink and nothing to eat within a week. Oh my God.
Come on, brother.
I'm telling you, in the church today, in the world, they're murmuring and complaining right now.
That's right.
That's what's going on in the body. Why? Because it's the same yesterday, today, and forever. God has showed us that we can learn from this pattern. Don't be like them.
Yeah, that's right.
Check this out. It gets better. It says, look, it says in chapter 16, verse 1 and 2, that they murmur and complain and they want to go back to Egypt. Now, it says, check this out. And it literally tells you, if you open your Bibles, go to Exodus chapter 16. God is so amazing. He's so amazing. Exodus chapter 16, and we're gonna look at chapter 16, verse 1 and 2. He says this. God, when he tells you a time, it's for a reason. It says, and they took their journey from Elam, and all the congregation of the children of Israel, which come out of the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elam and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after departing out of the land of Egypt. Listen, this is on the 15th day, right, of the second month of the following year. You with me? Am I right here?
Uh-huh.
No, I'm sorry. I got to go to the next one. Forgive me. So now they in the second month, in the second month after they departed out of the land of Egypt. So they left, they took that journey from Elam and all the congregation of the children of Israel, and they came to the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elam and Sinai. So I'm sorry, they just left Meribah and now they're moving, and he's given a date. Now, it says it was on the 15th day of the second month. This is 28 days into the Feast of First Fruits. That's today. What did you say? That is today. It was the 15th day of the second month, which was 28 days in the Feast of First Fruits.
Yeah.
On the Hebrew calendar, today is the 28th day of the counting of the Omer, May 21st. Today. Wow. So let's see what they was doing today. Watch this. It says that God gives them bread from heaven. and they begin to hoard it and not trust in God for their supply of each and every day. Today, God said, listen, I'm going to give you a double portion of the bread because I'm not going to give you none tomorrow on Sunday. Take up a double portion today so you'll have it for tomorrow. Today is a day of double portion.
Ooh, glory.
Wow! Today is a day of double portion. Straight from the Bible. What did they do? Monday? After they ate what they did, Monday, they gathered more than they were supposed to.
Come on.
God's trying to get them to trust in Him each and every day for their supply.
Yes.
But they hoarded the bread, and guess what? It bred worms.
Yes.
And it began to stink. Don't worry about putting in a bank. Invest it in God.
Amen.
Yes.
Wow. Let's see, what else? In Exodus chapter 17, now I just went 15, 16, 17, because God is bringing them to the mountain. Let's see what it says. In Exodus chapter 17, verse 1 through 4, they begin to complain again about water and drink to the point they would have stoned Moses. They wanted to leave and go back. I'm leaving. I ain't staying in this church no more. I'm gone. I had enough of this. That's what's going on in churches today. And God is telling them, man, what are you doing? I'm giving you the bread from heaven. You gonna leave? I want to go back to Egypt. I want to go back to where I was. I'm sorry. Egypt is dead. It's been destroyed. There's no food there. There's nothing. God utterly obliterated it. And you want to go back? There's nothing but forward. That's why the Lord says, put your eyes to the plow and don't look back. For anyone having put their eyes to the plow and looking back is not worthy of my kingdom. I ain't looking back. There ain't nothing there for me. There's nothing there for you. Nothing. Let's see this. Watch this. He says in Exodus chapter 17, verse 1 through 4, I'm going to read it. Exodus 17, 1 through 4. All the congregation of the children of Israel journeyed from the wilderness of Sin after their journeys according to the commandment of the Lord. So the Lord told them it was time to go, right? Of the Lord. And they pitched in Rephidim, which means rest. And there was no water for the people to drink. Wherefore the people did chide with Moses. They provoked him.
Come.
Now they're provoking Moses, their leader. Watch this. Wherefore the people did chide with Moses and said, give us water that we may drink. And Moses said unto them, why are you chiding with me? Wherefore do you tempt the Lord? Man, when we get out of line, it ain't got nothing to do with me.
Right.
You're dealing with the Almighty God.
Come on now. Amen.
Your beef is not with me.
That's right.
You're being fed with the manna from heaven.
Come on.
God Himself told me this is what He wanted to tell you today. Confirmed it through my mom.
Yeah.
And I didn't even talk to her.
Hallelujah.
But it's a message of encouragement, not to bring you down. What you've seen, He said, wrap your arms around them and love them because I love them.
Yes.
Listen to this. And the people thirsted for water, and the people murmured against Moses and said, wherefore is that thou hast brought us out of Egypt to kill us and all the children and with the cattle with thirst? And Moses cried unto the Lord, saying, what shall I do to these people? They already want to stone me.
Amen.
Man, how many pastors get in the firing line? You know how many pastors are going to get fired and done away with at this time?
Yeah, a bunch of them, okay.
They in the can, I'm son. Oh, he's not giving us what we want. We're not being fed like we want. He ain't preaching the good messages no more. We need to get rid of him, get another one.
Amen.
Right. It is, huh?
You know who's out of line? Them.
Right. Yes.
Not the pastor.
That's right. Amen.
Not the pastor. I'm sorry. People.
That's right.
The people. Because God has chosen ahead.
That's right.
To lead the people. But when the people start picking their heads, there's problems. So.
Amen.
They start picking heads. That won't sound too good, huh? I don't know about that, but picking heads. Stop picking heads. Let God give you His head, His shepherd, the one that He's provided for you, the one that shepherd can provide for the needs of what you need.
That's right.
Not what you think you need.
Right.
They thought they needed to go back. Oh, I wish I had that other guy. And God tried to do something, and man, get in the way. Watch this. Remember, this is in 49 days. They done witnessed the destruction of Pharaoh's army. They done witnessed the devastation of Egypt with all the plagues. The destruction of Pharaoh's army. God arms them. They see miracles that are mind-blowing. Mind-blowing. Part of Red Sea, 7 miles across. Open it up. Where they crossed was 1,000 foot deep. Who can do something like that? You worried about eating in a desert?
Come on.
Yeah. Ah, yeah, son. We ain't even a month into the journey or so, 2 months. Even raising one from the dead, Jesus said they wouldn't believe. Oh, if I could just see a miracle. That miracle's going to do nothing for you because you're going to deny it was a miracle, that they did something some kind of way. Oh, his body was just healed.
Amen.
Man, give me a break. A wicked and adulterous generation seeketh for a sign, and no sign shall be given unto them except Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
As he was in the belly of the whale 3 days and 3 nights, so must the Son of Man. That's your sign. There's none greater. No miracle, no Red Sea parting, no nothing is greater than the resurrection of the dead.
Amen.
Let's see what else is going on. Exodus chapter 17, 1 through 4. So God now provides for them from the rock, Jesus Christ. He split it, bam, and they drink the water. Okay. What's next? Exodus chapter 17, verse 8. Man, they right here at the mountain about to inherit.
Right.
Inherit. Your inheritance. You bring them to me because He is our inheritance. God was the inheritance of the children of Israel as the children was God's inheritance. He said it with His mouth.
That's right.
Man, they was about to receive from God. They were going to receive God. God was going to be with them and walk with them and talk with them and be their protector and provider and everything. And these guys, man, within 50 days, they want to run back over here. This is wasted. Look what he says right here in chapter 17, verse 8. Now, look, a war with Amalek.
Oh.
Before you can receive your promise.
Wow.
Amalek, his name means warlike. He was a giant. He was of the Amalekites. He was of the seed of the B'nai Elohim, the ones that have fallen and come down, of the lineage of Goliath, of Haman, of the lineage of Ham.
Wow.
The giants, they got a battle.
Right.
The B'nai Elohim of the fallen seed is there now to stop them from receiving their blessing from God. But you know what it took? Joshua.
Yeah.
So Moses stands up there. The children of Israel, hey, you remember what God gave you that armor for in Ephesians chapter 6? Put on a helmet of salvation, sword of spirit, shield of faith, breastplate of righteousness, gird about your loins with truth, and shod your shoes with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Well, he didn't give you that for no reason. He gave you that because it's wartime. And we're supposed to be using it. And let me tell you something. It's not good if someone's alone, because when he falls, he's down. But if two walk, wow, one is there to help him up. And a threefold cord is not easily broken.
Amen.
You better get with somebody. You better get with somebody. So now, the story. You know, before they inherit the Word of God, before you see on the 50th day of Pentecost, well, Joshua's got to do battle with Amalek. Why? Because he was of the Nephilim race. And that's Jesus. Joshua, symbolic to Christ, destroying the works of the enemy. Remember that? Moses, he holds his hands up. That's the only way you can win in this battle. That's the only way. Lord, you are my protector. In fact, Moses had to sit down and take rest. And Aaron and Hur had to hold his hands up. Aaron means bright, and Hur means splendor. So when you're holding your hands up, it's bright and splendorous. And when you're doing this, bam, the war on the enemy, he is just wiping them out. But as soon as your arms come down, you're finished.
Wow.
But it took an Aaron and a Hur to stand on side. Three-fold cord is not easily broken. To help the brother keep his hands up. Over the mountain, my brother called me. Under the sea,
wow.
I hear you come running. Your love for me. I hear that song in my head. He's holding my arms up. You can do it. Brother, I'm here for you. Man, there ain't nothing like having someone on side of you that can encourage you to keep going. If you don't have that, you better get one. And get two, you'll be better off. If you be able to spit. It ain't holy, it's disgusting. This spit, anyway. Thank you, Cherie, for the water. The Bible says, well, you gave me the water first. If you give a man of God some water, you receive his reward. So, Father, may you bless Cherie with the reward you have given me and my brother. In Jesus' name. Notice I didn't say prophet. I just prophesy the word of God. A prophet speaks the word of God, and that's what I do. I'll stay away from the title stuff. I love Jesus. So, before they can receive what it was that God had for them on the 50th day, well then, you know, they had to go through this war. Now check this out. On the 50th day, something amazing happens. And we could see this in Exodus chapter 17, I think it is. It says this. Let's see. Amalek, Jethro. Where am I at? All right. I got a... Lord, where's it at right here? Yeah, here. Is it 17? Is it 19? It says in verse 19, in the third month, when the children of Israel were gone forth out of the land of Egypt, the same day they came into the wilderness of Sinai. So now this is Pentecost, they there. This is in Exodus chapter 19. And before that, God tells them to, in Exodus 17, that, and the Lord said unto Moses, write this for memorial in a book and rehearse it in the ears of Joshua. And we're going to get into that after he had won the battle. But he says this, it says, watch this, man, this is amazing stuff. And Exodus chapter 19, because this is very important, because I'm showing you when, I'm going to show you how over and over again you're going to see when the Lord's going to return. Amazing stuff. It says that in Exodus chapter 19, it says in verse 16, now, in verse 7, it says that Moses came and called the elders of the people, and they laid before all the faces the words of the Lord that he commanded them, and all the people answered together and said, what the Lord has spoken, we will do. And remember, and then it goes up here, and it says in verse 16, it says that, and it came to pass on the third day in the morning, that there were thunders and lightnings and a thick cloud upon the mount, and the voice of a trumpet exceeding louder, so that all the people that was in the camp trembled. So here it is. You're going to have the lightnings, the sound of the trumpet. You know, we know about atonement, and they talk about the Lord returning in, but you know, guys, how I told you how it was all switched. And Moses brought forth the people out of the camp to meet with God. When did they meet God? Watch this. Here it is. God descends on the mountain. This is on Pentecost. And he brings them out to meet the Lord. They're going to inherit. God's coming down. That's the whole thing. He's coming down on a mountain with voices and thunders and lightnings. And he descended on it in fire. And he came down in a cloud. And what? And then it says, we go on reading that Moses went up. Right? To what we was going to inherit. Let's go to the next one. You guys can read it and check it out for yourself. Now let's look at this right here. In Numbers chapter 9 and 10. Now, I just showed you from Passover to Pentecost. I don't have time to go deeper into the coming of the Lord with that. Now I want to show you from Passover to Pentecost again. Right? Now look at Numbers chapter 10. But this time, I'm going to show it to you in Numbers chapter 9 and 10, where there was an Egypt. Look at this. There was an Egypt, and they went to the Red Sea, and then they went to the mountain of the Lord, and God came down. Now they're at the mountain of the Lord. Right? And they stayed there a year.
Wow.
Right? Now I'm going to show you from Passover again to Kadesh Barnea. Which is the promised land of telling the 12 spies to go up into the land, go up and receive. So let's see what's going on between Mount Sinai, between Passover again, and between Kadesh Barnea, between the Feast of First Fruits and Pentecost. Let's see what's happening again.
Okay.
You with me?
Yeah.
All right, let's check this out. Numbers chapter 9 and 10, it says right here, read Numbers chapter 9 verse 5. So this is about their journeys. Numbers chapter 9, verse 5. It says, let me read it and start in verse chapter 9, verse 1. And the Lord spake unto Moses in the wilderness of Sinai in the first month in the second year. The first month, the second year. So this is during Passover time, but the second year. After they will come out of the land of Egypt, saying, let the children of Israel also keep the Passover. And at his appointed season.
Yeah.
Right? So they got to keep it. In the 14th day of this month, at the evening, you shall keep it as it was appointed in its season, according to the rites of it, and according to all the ceremonies thereof, you shall keep it. And Moses spake unto the children of Israel that they should keep the Passover. So, hey, Passover is on the 14th, right? The 10th. Yeah, you brought the lamb in, they kill it on the 14th. Here we are now. They're doing it again. The 14th. They're killing the Passover. And it says in verse 4, In verse 4, and Moses spoke unto the children of Israel that they should keep the Passover. And they kept the Passover on the 14th day of the first month, just like God said a year ago. They did the exact same thing, right? At evening in the wilderness of Sinai, according to all that the Lord had commanded Moses, so did the children of Israel do. So they kept it. Let's see what else is next. So if we read, here's the Passover being kept. They at Mount Sinai, they're keeping the Passover. So the Passover is celebrated, and God tells them about the guidance of the cloud, right? In 9 and 10. Let me see where that's at. Okay, here we go. So go to verse chapter 9, verse 15. So now, check this out. At Passover time, they went on a move before, right? Remember, they was on a move. It was time to move. Here it is again. Watch this. It's Passover time. Now look at verse 15. It's called the guidance of the cloud. And on the day that the tabernacle was reared up, a cloud covered the tabernacle, namely the tent of testimony. That's you and me. Jesus was the tent of testimony. Now the Spirit of the Lord lives inside of you and me, and we are a tent of testimony, the testimony of Jesus Christ. That's who we are, right? And when the cloud, in verse 17, wait, verse 16. No, verse 15. Going back up. And on the day that the tabernacle was reared up and the cloud covered the tabernacle, namely the tent of testimony, and at evening there was upon the tabernacle as it was an appearance of fire. That's why cloven like tongues of fire came down on the day of Pentecost. Until the morning. So it was always the cloud covered it by day and the appearance of fire by night. And when the cloud was taken up from the tabernacle, then after that the children of Israel journeyed, and the place where the cloud abode is the children of Israel pitched their tents. And at this command, at the going forth, and when the cloud raised, they moved, and when the cloud settled, they rested. They're moving again. Same time. An actual, exact repeat. Now check this out. Now, we're going to go from chapter 9 to chapter 10. And I encourage you guys to go read this stuff for yourself so you see it, okay? I'm giving you the cleft notes, the highlights. Now we're going to look at, let's read chapter 10. Let's read chapter 10, verse 11 through 13. Chapter 10, verse 11 through 13. Now, I want to show you right here, in chapter 10, in verse 1, we see the guidance of the trumpets. The trumpets are mentioned here. But check this out. Numbers chapter 10, verse 11 through 15. And it came to pass on the 20th day of the second month, in the second year, the 20th day of the second month, well, that's 33 days into the Feast of First Fruits. Mm-hmm. That's 33. Why? He's giving you these days, these numbers for a reason. So, and it came to pass on the 20th day of the second month, that's 33 days, we know because the Feast of First Fruits started on the 17th day of Nisan in the first month. So if we go to the 17th day of the second month, plus 3 days would be the 20th day, right? You with me? So that would be 33. There's your 33, Colt. Remember that? So 33. So in the second year that the cloud was taken up from the tabernacle of testimony, and the children of Israel took their journeys out of the wilderness of Sinai, and the cloud rested in the wilderness of Paran, and they first took their journey according to the commandment of the Lord by the hand of Moses. Here it is. And just check this out. They're moving again. God takes them from one place, puts them in another. The exact same thing happens the next year at the same time, an exact repeat. So you can only imagine if what happened the year before, could it happen again? Could it happen again? Well, let's see what happens. So now it says right here in chapter 11. Let's go to chapter 11. Let's read chapter 11. So we know now that 33 days into the Feast of First Fruits, chapter 11. Chapter 11. Watch this. Patterns. Chapter 11. And when the people complained, what? No way! No way! Impossible! Well, that's as it was, so it shall be.
Yeah.
It's just a repeating cycle, right? And when the people complained, it displeased the Lord, and the Lord heard it. And his anger was kindled, and the fire of the Lord burned among them and consumed them that were in the uttermost parts of the camp. Son, he broke out on them. I'm tired of the murmuring and the complaining. These people were just saved by the blood, baptized in the sea. They experienced all the goodness of God. God descending down on a mountain in fire, hearing the voice of God. They ain't gone but 33 days and complaining again. These stupid and stiff-necked people. That's me. I hate this language. I'm stupid. Well, it's me. It's us. It's us.
Yes, it is.
We people, but he loves us. You know what I mean? So check this out. So look what they read about. And we ain't going to go all through 11. You can read it for yourself. Check this out. In chapter 11, we read they complain about their circumstances. They complain about food. Then they complain about food. Moses starts complaining. Now the shepherd's complaining. That's me. Oh, Lord. Lord, what am I doing with these people? The Bible says, confess your sins one to another that you may be forgiven. Am I forgiven?
Yes.
Thank you. Because then it's your problem. So Moses starts complaining about the people. Moses complains about his own life. Wow. Mo, like, man, you know, I was in with Jethro,
yeah,
with the sheep.
Yeah.
I had plenty. I had land. He had all kinds of stuff. And you bring me over here to lead these stiff-necked people. But you know what? You always seen Moses stepping between God and the people. Because he was a true shepherd.
Yes, he was.
And he loved his sheep.
Yes.
He was an intercessor.
Yes, he was.
And when he wasn't able to, he said, Aaron, get an offering. Go stand before, slay a sacrifice, and get between God and the people. That the wrath stop.
Yeah.
That Aaron is the high priest, bright and splendid. That's Jesus Christ. He is bright and splendorous. Jesus. He stands between the wrath of God and me and you.
Yeah.
Who is that? That's Jesus Christ.
Yes, it is.
That's why you better have Jesus when you stand before God.
Yes,
well, there's a man between me and you, and you ain't. All he sees is Jesus.
Yeah.
Right.
So he holds his hands out like that, and you standing behind Jesus like that, all he sees is Jesus.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Well done, my good and faithful servant, enter in.
Hallelujah.
Isn't that good?
Hallelujah.
Isn't God good?
Oh.
We can learn from His Word. Watch this. It says that after He does this, it says that God sends him. He consumes it with fire. Right after that, that ain't enough. Now they start complaining about not their circumstances before. Now they complain about food. So He sends them quails till they walking in it knee deep until they choking on the meat.
Yes.
And then He makes a disease break out on them. Bam! Can I tell you this? It's all between the Feast of First Fruits and Pentecost. Are you kidding me? Is that a possibility? Watch this. Check this out. It says that he provides quail and he sends plagues. Listen, we in the Feast of First Fruits. You know what happens next? You know what happens next? Miriam and Aaron start talking about Moses. You know Moses. Man, he married a black woman, a Cushite. He's got two sons by a black woman. That's Miriam, who was just...
Yeah.
What was that? Look, well, how many days prior to this? He was doing the temple stuff. The horse and rider thrown into the sea. All about the Moses and how God used him. Now she's talking about her own brother with the high priest. Like Aaron, I threw the gold in the fire and I'll jump the ox. Okay. Here it is, Moses, you know, Aaron and Miriam are talking about Moses, their own brother. What do you think was going on in the camp? Who else do you think they were talking to? Wow. I can tell you right now, in churches around this place, in the world today, they're talking about that pastor.
Right. Yeah.
Not only talking about that pastor, they're talking about people. You know what he did? You know what she did? Let me tell you something. They in trouble.
Right.
If they don't repent. And I'm going to tell you another thing. If you hold harbiness, if you harbor bitterness toward those people who are talking about you, you're in trouble.
Right.
Yeah. Seeds of unforgiveness.
That's right.
Just let it go. Just let it go. Love Jesus.
Yeah.
Let it go. It ain't even worth it. Man, I was, when I tell you rejected, I was the epitome, you can ask my wife, of rejection in a church.
Amen.
I was called out and slammed in front of the congregation.
Amen.
Twice.
What?
But you know what?
But speaking truth.
I said, you know what? I'm not going nowhere. I'm staying put.
That's right. Stay.
Nowhere. My mama said, let's go. We ain't never coming back to this church again.
I did.
But you know what?
That was the mama.
That's right.
That's a protective mama. I looked at my mom. I said, you know what? I was told in front of a congregation, I'm unsteady as planks. I'm up and down and up and down. I said, though it hurt, it's the truth. And maybe because he did it, the way he did it was wrong, but I'm not going to harbor bitterness against him. It made me a better person.
Yeah.
How would you like to be rebuked in front of 600 people? Twice.
Wow.
It made me better though. It made my heart thick. Mama ain't raising no baby. I used to run and hide. I ain't running hard no more. You know what? It's what I needed. And God will give you what you need in the time that you need it. Why? Because He loves you. And if you can handle the chastening of God, if you can handle correction, you're gonna go with God. Anybody that can handle correction,
amen,
from someone who loves them.
That's right.
Because if you know a person loves you, you receive the correction. If someone doesn't love you, you need to do this, you need to do that, you'll never receive that. But when God tells you, you know it.
Yeah.
I knew it. Though it was coming from a man out of the flesh, the words He spoke was God straight to my problem. You're unsteady as planks.
Yeah.
Thank you, Father, for that word you've given me in front of 600 people twice. Because I'm established because of that word. And I love him. I love the pastor who did that to me. Love him. And that man had more love than anybody. Golly. Anyway. Let's see. Is this good? It's good stuff, huh? Check this out. So Moses, now, here it is. So Miriam and Aaron rebel against Moses between the Feast of First Fruits and Pentecost. What does Moses do? Moses intercedes for Miriam, and she's restored after 7 days. Why 7 days? Because the next day is Pentecost. You know what the next day is? God tells him, send 12 spies into the land. It's yours. Go take it. Ooh, they're inheriting the promised land on the 50th day of Pentecost. They had to go up the mountains into the land, into the promised land, come back with grapes. That's a pattern. When are we going to inherit our promised land? When are we going to go up? Ooh! Could it be on Pentecost? I don't know. Let's keep looking. He's amazing. Check this out. Ooh! On Pentecost, they at now Kadesh Barnea on the 50th day, and God tells them to go up and spy out and receive the land that has been promised to you. But they come back 40 days later with a bad report. Moses went up on Pentecost, came down 40 days later. Can you see something? And the children of Israel didn't receive the word. He had to throw the commandments down and they broke.
Right.
Ah! Is that not a pattern? He's a pattern God. He moves in the Moed, the feast and the festivals, the cycles. I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. You can learn from me, says the Lord. Read my word. Everything we need is there. Stop complaining, church. Stop complaining, church.
Right.
Stop complaining. We can look and see and learn from the examples that has been set before us. Don't ever think you know it all.
Amen.
I know a lot. No, I know a little bit about the Bible. And I still have to read it. Still have to.
Amen.
Because I don't want one word in season. Like my wife texts me, it's better than 10,000 words out of season. I don't want to just come here and bring you what I know. I want to tell you what's going to change your life, what's going to encourage you, that's going to make you want to keep going, that makes you want to stay here and move and press toward Pentecost. The receiving of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
Your rightful inheritance. Let's keep looking. So after going in the land for 40 days, they get a year for a day. The 12 spies come back, and only Joshua and Caleb come back with a good report. Now Joshua's name means Jesus. He goes in with Caleb at 85 years old. Caleb, his name means dog, the dog of the Gentiles. We see the Jews and the Gentiles, Joshua and Caleb, the Jews and the Gentiles inheriting the land. They're the only two that come back with a good report. The 10 other ones, when they came back with a bad report on Pentecost, God killed them. You heard me? He killed them. They died. All 10 of them. 10 law judgment fell on them. Because they didn't receive the promise of the Lord. Judgment hit them. They didn't come back with a good report. Sound familiar? When Moses came down off the mountain, after 40 days they came back. They didn't believe God. He killed them. Moses came off of the mountain after 40 days later. 3,000 turned against Moses. They died.
Amen.
Ugh. Is that not a pattern? Yes, it is. Our God is amazing. Isn't it? This is better than the prediction of the weather. A storm's coming.
Right.
It's more accurate than, like I said, Margaret Orr, son.
That's right.
More accurate than her, than Edward Casey and Notre Dame. Man, we have something that is sure, that is pop. This is perfect in every way.
Yes.
If you want to know what's going to happen, right here, baby. Here it is.
Woo!
You want to know what's going on? Right here. All you have to do is do this. Face to face. Get you some bread. Stop complaining about where you're at. You're not eating. Why are you not eating? The bread's there. You know why you're sick and dying? You know why you're unhealthy and unnourished? Because you don't eat.
Amen.
And when you don't eat, you begin to complain.
That's right.
Mmm.
That's right.
I know, I've been there.
No.
I preach to the choir, me. I'm a man like you.
That's right.
Man, let's keep going. Let's see what else had happened. Check this out. Does it happen again? Yes, it happens again. And Joshua chapter 1 through chapter 6. Now, I'm not going to get into all of it because I need to get to where I'm going. But Joshua chapter 1, chapter 6, he's at the Jordan. When is he at the Jordan? On the 10th day of Nisan. Are you telling me? What's he about to do? Inherit the promised land. But what does he have to do? So the Bible says that Joshua, in Joshua chapter 1 through chapter 6, he's got to keep the feast of Passover. So on the 10th day of Nisan, he crosses over the Jordan. He goes to Gilgal, which means circle or cycle or circuit. There is a circumcision, a cutting away of the flesh. Remember all of that? And it says, and they keep the feasts while they were there. Oh, no. You want to see the 7 days again?
Uh-huh.
7 days before Pentecost, God tells him. Why does he wait 7 days before Pentecost? So Joshua keeps the feast. God tells him to move their encampment across the Jordan into the promised land, but it ain't theirs yet. They didn't inherit it. Why? Because Jericho's there. They got to keep the feast. And 7 days prior to Pentecost. Why does he wait 7 days prior to Pentecost? Now let's think about this. They just came out of the wilderness for 40 years. They don't kick more butt. They don't kick, you know, the king of Bashan and all of those guys right before they got to where they at, before Moses dies. They armed, they're bad, 600,000 men surrounding the camp. They, you know, all the other ones were wasted in the wilderness because they didn't believe God. The children are raised up, they all armed, ready for battle. There's 108,000 in the front, 180,000 in the back, 150,000 on each side. They got the sign of the cross, they set up out of Jordan. Moses goes up on Mount Nebo, Joshua takes over, the Spirit is imparted into him right there at Jordan. Now they're going over. They now in the land that flows with milk and honey, they all heard about what God done to the king of Bashan and Og, who had a bedstead of 13 and a half feet. That was a big dude. He heard about how they obliterated the Egyptians, parted the Red Sea, and it says their knees were knocking, baby, when they came across the river because they knew they were next. And then, you don't think these guys are encouraged and ready to take Jericho? God tells them, oh, by the way, pull up your sword. You're just going to walk around the building and blow a horn. Wait. 7 days prior to Pentecost of them taking it.
You don't speak.
God says, no. They in the Feast of First Fruits. 7 days, like Miriam. She was a leper for 7 days. He couldn't do nothing. God said, I don't want you to do nothing. All I want you to do is take out your horns and walk around it. I wonder if there was any murmuring and complaining. Did you hear what Moses said? Can you see him in their camps? I mean, look at us. We're ready. Look at all the stuff we've done. He's telling, he wants the people to go walk around Jericho 6 times, and on the 7th day, 7 times, 13 total, we're just with the horns out there. I think, you know, Joshua, he ain't like Moses. Moses would have said, just go up there and take it. Remember, Moses is dead. Joshua's in command. But God told Joshua, today, I'm going to magnify you in the face of the people.
That's right. That's what he said.
Joshua, he tells him, hey, put your swords up, take out your horns. Oh, wait, hold on a second here. It kind of sounds like somebody we know in the Bible, right? Who else? Who else took a horn and a light? Gideon?
Yeah.
Surely this is the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. Put your swords up, brother. Just here, let's take a light. 32,000 men. God said, that's too many. After 32,000, 2,000, that's too many. 10,000, that's too many. I bring them to the wall and I'm going to test them. Oh, there's 300? Yeah, 300 against 60,000.
Amen.
I said, you heard me? Hey, what? We going at him with a light and a horn? Boy, what did you say? Hey, man, it's 60,000 men over there. All right, men, put up your swords, get your lights and your horns. You think there was a merman complaining?
Oh, yeah.
I guarantee you, those 300 that were left were bad to the bone, son.
Amen.
They wasn't scared of nothing. They believed their God.
That's right, amen.
You gotta believe in something to take a lamp and a horn. Number one, a lamp, they're going to know where we at.
That's right.
Blow a horn. Here I am. Come kill me. Man, that's talking in the camp, man. This is reality. This is people.
That's right.
First fruits in Pentecost. What was going on? Well, in Joshua, between first fruits and Pentecost, they keep the feast and all that. And 7 days before Pentecost, 7 days before Pentecost, God says, now I want you to start walking around Jericho. Now I'm going to give you the scripture. On the 50th day of Pentecost, after walking around it 7 times, I want you to go to Joshua chapter 6, verse 20. Joshua chapter 6. Joshua chapter 6. Because God repeats himself over and over. Joshua chapter 6, verse 20. The details are unbelievable. He says, so the people shouted with the priests and blew the trumpets. And it came to pass when the people heard the sound of the trumpet. Wow. Wait, hold on a second. The Lord comes, right? With the voice of the ark of the angel of the Lord, the shout. What were they doing? They were shouting. What was going on? They was blowing the trumpet. Ooh, that's what it talks about in the Bible when the Lord comes. With the shout and the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God. Right? He comes to gather together his elect. Well, what happens here in verse 20? Watch this. It says in verse 20, so the people shouted with the priests and they blew the trumpets, and it came to pass when the people heard the sound of the trumpet, the people shouted with a great shout and the wall fell down so that the people went up. What did you say? He went up into the city. Not down. Went up. Pentecost, baby. It's all about coming down and going up. The Holy Spirit came down right on Pentecost, right? And we go up.
Amen.
It repeats itself over and over. Let's keep going. Now, let's look. I'm give you this last one. Jesus. All of this right here is about Jesus. This is God telling us what he's going to do. Telling us what's going to happen. Telling us what to expect. So that we can be prepared. And we know that when we fall in these times that we're in, going through things, and that, hey, God said these things would happen. We just need to be encouraged. I want to encourage you today to keep going.
Amen.
He loves you. Watch this. Let's look at it. Acts chapter. In Acts, Jesus rides into Jerusalem on the 10th day of Nisan. Wow. Same day. He's killed on the 14th. And he's raised on the Feast of First Fruits, the 17th day of Nisan. What happened between the Feast of First Fruits and Pentecost? What happened to the church? Well, let's see. I know. Peter said, I don't know about y'all. I'm going fishing.
Amen.
He's going back to what he knows. I don't know about y'all. I'm going fishing. James and John and Andrew, I'm coming with you. They were fishermen. This is reality. This is happening right now in our time that we're in. And people said, I don't know about you. I ain't coming to this church no more. I'm leaving. They're going to do that right now. People are leaving church right now.
right.
That's what they're doing, because that's what it says. Look, over and over, complaining, murmuring, or talking about the past, or doing all of these things that's going on. That's what's happening at that time. It repeats itself every year. Every year. Watch this. Let's see what else is going on. Peter and them, they go back fishing. Now, Mary runs to the tomb and Jesus appears to Mary when she runs to the tomb. So Mary is the first witness that Jesus Christ had rose from the dead. She was the first preacher. She took that message. Oh, wait, hold on a second. Women can't preach. Are you crazy?
Hallelujah. Amen.
Your sons and daughters would preach, prophesy. Mary was the first one who preached the gospel. He's alive. He rose from the dead. That's the gospel.
That's right.
The good news is he's alive.
And Jesus told me to tell you.
And Jesus told me to tell you that. Okay. Now, what happens next? Unbelief. He ain't a lot, man. What happens next? They're in disbelief. They're all confused. They're hiding. They don't know what to do. Confusions abound. And Mary, he's alive. Mary is a nutcase.
Yeah.
Oh, like he appeared to you, a woman. We're the disciples. We were with him 3.5 years. Who are you that he appeared to you?
You're a woman.
You're a woman.
I washed his feet.
I'm Mary. He told me to tell you. Get out of here, Mary. That's what I would say. Man, I walk with him. I was his right hand. I'm John. And he appeared to you? Woman, you're crazy. You're nuts. He would definitely appear to John or Peter before they appear to you. Wrong. The bride. She's the only one that went looking for him. Oh! What did you say? Jesus said he'd raise again in 3 days. She was the only one looking for him. She was the only one that believed. That's fresh, hot off the grill, right from heaven. She's the only one that believed in the resurrection. That's why she went. He was already risen. As yet. It's me. Rabboni, teacher, Mary. Oh my God. He's alive. Didn't he say he would be raised from the dead? No. No. Peter and John. Now John was younger. Peter was a big dude. He was a little older than John. John was young. He just kind of ran past Peter like that. But you know what John did? He stopped. Bam. But Peter went in. Where he at? That's what I'm talking about. Are you looking for him? This is all in that time. Wow. Let's see what else is going on. Disbelief and confusion. Denial and hiding. Then Jesus appears to his disciples and encourages them. This is a time of encouragement, my brethren, my people, you guys. He loves you. He appears to them and encourages them. So it ain't all about, yeah, look, the murmuring and the complaining and all this kind of stuff. It's time to be encouraged, says the Lord. Encouraged today?
Yes.
Watch this. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1 through 6, what else happened there? It says that Jesus appears to over 500 before he's taken up.
Amen.
More than 500. During the Feast of First Fruits. He appears to them. More than 500 see him. And he tells them to go wait till you be endued with power.
Amen.
Not many days hence, 10 days from now. Go wait and tarry for the promise of the Holy Spirit's going to come and dwell right here so that you'll be empowered to take the land. What is the land? People. So you can go get God's inheritance for him.
Yes.
Wow. Go get my inheritance. What is God's inheritance? It's not physical land, brother.
It's people.
Amen.
Go get my people. Out of the 500, only 120 believed. 380. Later. And I ain't coming back. 380 of them are walking out the church. Times a million. I don't believe none of this stuff. This church here, this and that. They're walking out the door and missing out on what God has for them.
Amen.
And it's only days away. It's only days away. The Bible says the 380 left and the 120 that were there that received were all in one accord.
That's right.
One accord. You know what one accord means? One mind, the mind of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
They had the mind of Jesus Christ, so they remained. And they received the outpouring of the power of the Holy Spirit that empowers you and me to preach the gospel. That, like this morning, the words that came forth, think about what was said this morning. I didn't even talk to my mama. She walked in, the Spirit is here. I could feel Him. God is telling me we need to stop complaining. Oh my God. Oh my God.
Coincidence.
But also, this is a time of healing. God, I was in praise and worship. I want you to come up here. Get on your guitar. Go get on your guitar. Pete, John, take y'all positions. I want you. Let me tell you something. I've never ever given an altar call in this church, I don't think.
No.
Never.
No.
God said today. He said, I want to speak to my people. He said, I want to heal my people. Hope walked in and telling me about somebody who needs healing. They're going to be healed. Hope. They're going to be healed. No doubt. Because that's where we're at right now. Man. Tell you something that's absolutely amazing. Watch this. I called my wife up this morning. And I said, hey, you know, I want you to bring me the Hebrew calendar. For 2016, it's just keeping up with, you know, different things. And I said, I want to look at it to see where we at today. You know? So she bring me the calendar today. And today is the 28th day of the counting of the Omer. Now the Omer is counted for 49 days and then Pentecost. This is the 28th day of the counting of the Omer. I was sitting up there before I got this calendar, before my wife walked in, and I told my brother this morning, I said, the Lord wants to have an altar call this morning. Right where you at. Right where you at. I said, because the Lord told me He's going to heal people today. Now, let me tell you, if you know me, that's, you know, I don't say that often. Rare. I give you the word and all that kind of stuff, but I told you that God was here and He was going to manifest Himself in a huge way. Because the presence of God is here. You received a message straight from Jesus Christ this morning. Not from me. This message didn't have anything to do with me. He showed me. This is what I want you to tell them. I want you to encourage them to keep going because I have something for them.
Right.
Don't give up. Don't stop. Don't walk out the door. He cares about this little body enough to show up and talk to you and me.
That's right.
Thank you, Lord.
We ain't a big old huge church, but we are a gathering of people who love Jesus.
Amen.
And it says, where two or more gathered, there He is in the midst. And God spoke to me Friday and said, this is what I want you to tell him. I want you to encourage him. I was telling my brother, man, they're going to be encouraged. They're going to be so encouraged. So I'm sitting back there on the chair with him. And I said, Jason, the Lord wants to have, yeah, that's good. The Lord, he wants to heal the people. He wants to heal them. That's what he wants to do. He wants to touch them. He wants to encourage them. The Lord said, they're going to be people who wants to quit, that has given up hope. And listen to me. No message could touch you that I could preach. The only one that could touch you is God. And I promised you today, if you came, he was going to touch you. I can't get into places that he can, but I know the word that I was carrying today was from the throne.
Yeah.
So I knew and could say with a promise that he was going to touch you. Because it wasn't my words. I'm not here to preach a good message. I'm here to give you his message, his word that you need right now, that he loves you. He loves you so much. Golly. The only one that can express that kind of love. I can't, but he could use me to show forth his love in a way. Whenever people describe Jesus, they always describe him as love first and light. That's why he wanted to wrap his arms around you today. It was him letting you know he loves you. It doesn't matter what you've done. It don't matter. Forgive.
Amen.
It don't matter who you talk to, what you said to them. It's over. It's done with. It's in the past. It's a new beginning, a new start. Be encouraged. God has something for you and me. We have a promised land that's coming. And I'm not talking about another building. No telling where God's going to take us next. I don't know. I have no idea. But I'm following the cloud. You can come if you want, but when the cloud goes, I'm gone. I'm gone. I want to be in the cloud. I want to be in his presence. And you know what? Right now, his presence is here. But he's preparing us. Something's coming. So, I told my brother, hold on one sec. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, go ahead.
Confirm what you said last week.
Wow. Wow. Watch. Hold on. Watch this. Healing is coming. That's a confirmation. Watch this. You know, I went up there and I told my brother, I said, man, the Lord wants to have an altar call today. He wants to heal people physically and spiritually. He wants to heal them today. Today he wants to heal you. My wife walks in. I told my brother. He bears witness to it. Sitting right there, I tell him what God wants to do today. In praise and worship, God starts naming things he wants to do. I'm going to read them to you in a minute. My wife walks in and gives me the calendar. I look at the calendar, and it's the 28th day of the counting of the Omer. Do you want to know what the reading is today? See what the reading is today. Hey, put up Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4, verse 16 through 21. Today, almost 2,000 years ago, Jesus stood in a synagogue and said this. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And his custom was, as he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath, the very day today he did this, and stood up to read. And there was delivered to him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted. He preached deliverance to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised." Go ahead. "To preach the acceptable year of the Lord." And he closed the book. 2,000 years ago, on this very day, he stood up and said, today, he's the anointed one that wants to heal the brokenhearted. My God, the message came directly from the throne. On the very day he preached it. And God said, this is what he told me. Maybe you hurt. Maybe you've been running. Maybe you're tired. Maybe you've become hard. Maybe you're ready to give up. Maybe you're tired of being rejected. Maybe you don't understand why you're going through the things you're going through. Maybe you're battling finances. Maybe you're holding unforgiveness. Maybe you've been asking for a fresh touch. Well, the Lord says, now is the day. Now is the time. That Jesus Christ himself showed up here in the spirit to give you a message that he loves you and he forgives you and he just wants to be with you. He forgives you of all sin. No matter what you've been going through, no matter what you've been doing, no matter what you've been saying. He said, there's hope. There's hope. Wow. There's hope. There's Jesus. Receive in Jesus' name what you've been asking for. Father, in Jesus' name. Yes. Get his daddy to watch, to see this message. Man, I'm telling you, God is here to heal you. No matter what it is, spiritually, physically, he's here to, like he says, set the captives free, deliver you, touch you, heal you, whatever, your back, your mind, your body. Whatever you've been going through, whatever the enemy has been using against you, man, if you really believe, man, stand up. If you want it, stand up. There's your altar right there. Stand up if you want it. Father, you're good, Lord. Father, you're good, Lord. Father, Lord, we come before you right now, Lord. And Father, Lord, I just ask you to forgive us, Father. Father, and cleanse us, like your word says, from all unrighteousness. Purge us, Lord, and make us whole. Father, you give the word today. It was your word that came forth because you wanted to encourage him, to tell the people there is a hope, there is forgiveness, there is love. It doesn't matter where you is at or what people has done to you. Man, forgive them so that you can be forgiven. So Father, in Jesus' name, we stand before the altar in heaven, the very throne of God, because we know you're here, because you delivered this word to us, Lord. Father, I pray right now that your healing power that's already here, that's already in a hospital by Scott's dad, that's already by Hope's friend, Lord, that your healing power right now, Father, would move through each and every one of us that's here. And Father, we send it out to those who are suffering right now. Lord, to Christians around the world, Lord, that are going through things. Father, that they would be encouraged, Lord. Father, we bind the enemy in Jesus' name. Father, we bind him up and we call those who are walking out to turn around and come back into church in Jesus' name. Come back in Jesus' name. Get off of them, devil. I bind and rebuke you in the name of Yeshua. All power and all authority has been given unto us through the name of Jesus Christ. So by the power in the name of Jesus Christ, we take authority over the sicknesses, over the diseases, Lord. We rebuke them in Jesus' name. Bind them and cast them out. We command them to leave in Jesus' name off of every one of us that's here. And Father, impart the Spirit, Lord, into them. Impart hope and encouragement. And that they want to go out and tell others, Father, how good you are. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your love. We thank you for your healing power. We thank you, Father, for Pentecost. We thank you for the power that came down. We thank you, Father, that you're raising us up to be with you, Lord. And Lord, we seek a city whose builder and maker is you, is God. Father, we're not worried about buildings or anything like that, Father. We're worried about people, Lord, touching lives, bringing them to you, Lord. Father, I pray right now for the power of the Holy Spirit to fall upon us, Lord, so that we're able to go take the land for you, Father, in Jesus' name. Lord, that when we begin to speak to people, Lord, they just crumble and want to come to you. I ask for that power. Receive that power right now in Jesus' name to transform lives, to win people for you, Lord. The sword of the Spirit, Lord, and the sword of the Lord. Yes. Thank you for healing Scott's daddy, Lord. Thank you for healing Hope's friend, Lord. Thank you for healing my back and healing my children and healing my brothers and sisters and healing us, Father. Thank you for forgiving us, Lord. Thank you that we don't even have to think about it anymore, but Lord, our eyes are focused on Pentecost, Lord. Our inheritance, Father, our Pentecost, Lord, is you. You are our Pentecost. You are the fire. You are what we long for, Lord. It's not about houses and money, Father. You are our inheritance, and we are yours, Father. Thank you, Father, for your word. Thank you, Lord, that you poured life back into us, Father, in me, and the people that were here, Father, that needed it. We needed a fresh touch from you, Lord. Thank you for showing up, Lord, and confirming it, Lord. Thank you for bringing the ones that are here today because, Lord, you wanted to speak to them. You wanted to encourage them. You wanted to give them a word from the throne. He loves us. He loves us. And we are his body. We are the ones that's been called out. And he's the head to do what he's called us to do. To love people. To impart life into them, not death. Not talk about them. Forgive them. Today is a new day, says the Lord. Today is a new day, says the Lord. Father, thank you for loving us, Lord. Thank you for your healing, Lord, especially in our inner man that gives us the hope to keep going, Lord. You always show up at the right time, Lord. Thank you for a direct word from the throne of God, from the throne of heaven, from your throne, that you care enough about us, Father, to come down and be with us. Thank you for being with us wherever we go. Thank you for encouraging me and my wife and my family, Lord. Lord, I ask that you would just pour your love out on my wife, Father. Pour your love out on the women that are here today, Lord. Pour your love out on the men that's here today, Father. Help us to see through your eyes, Lord. Help us to hear with the ears of our heart, Lord.
So worthy of praise is the Lord. So worthy of praise.
Paul, can you turn my mic so I can
praise?
Father, we're just here to worship you, Lord. Father, we ain't worried about these words. Keep playing.
Thank you, Father.
Father, we just thank you, Lord, for who you are. Father, we thank you for filling up this house, oh God. Father, we just thank you for being here. Father, we thank you for dying on a cross, Lord. Father, we thank you for being in us, oh God, living in us, oh Lord. Father, we just thank you for calling us out by name, oh Lord. Father, we just thank you for forgiving us, oh God, Father. Father, we just thank you. That's all we can do is just thank you. Father, we just want to bow down and worship you. Father, we in your presence, I know everywhere in the Word of God, when the presence of God fell, there was no singing and dancing. You was in worship before God. Your eyes did not look upon him. Your knees were knocking. You was at his feet. I've been at his feet for months. Worship him. Father, I thank you for who you are and giving us boldness, Lord, to be able to come to your throne, oh God. But we come trembling and walking very lightly to your throne. Father, I want to walk in your blood, walk in your presence. I don't want to trample on any of it. Father, I want to handle your word very, very carefully. And I want to dig with a spoon so I don't miss anything. Father, give us a desire for your word.
Praise thee. So that the people will just be drawn in, Lord, so we can tell them of your goodness and tell them of your mercy and not scream on the streets they're going to hell and they need to repent and all of this kind of stuff, Lord. Father, you are a loving God, Father. You love us, Lord. Help us to portray you in the true light, Father, in true light, in true holiness. So, Father, I just pray right now as we go forward, Lord, that your presence would go with us, Father. Because we are the tent tabernacle, Lord. We are the tabernacle of testimony, the carrier of your presence that's been sent forth to go into the world. So, Father, we ask that the power of the Holy Spirit, the fire, Father, would set on us, Lord. And that wherever we go, Father, we consume people, Father, with your love, with your word, as a testimony of your goodness, Father. Thank you for the word that came from you today. We thank you for encouraging us, Lord, to keep going. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. And amen. Guys, be blessed. Thank you.
I'll write it for that. I'll write it for that one.
You got a testimony?
I throw soup in
there. To the people.
Hold up to your mouth so we can hear you.
When the Lord listens to the people in here, I had my hand on Tony's back because I know he's been suffering on his back. And I had my other hand on Madge's back. And I heard pop, like pop, 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 pop. It was me.
What?
It was me. He was popping my back and my neck.
Wow.
I said, what's all that popping? I realized it's me.
He's the chiropractor, huh?
I'm telling you, I felt it. It was, it sounded like popcorn. Pop, 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 pop. And it took me 4 hours. That's me. How many people have been touched? And you know it. Come on, get up and say what you've been
touched.
Come on.
I know.
You know you've been touched from something.
Touched.
You felt God heal you in your body.
I have been touched. I have no pain at all.
Praise God.
Amen.
I'll add to that too. My hips have been bothering me, particularly my artificial hip. It's gone. I don't feel it anymore. I'm telling you, he was here today. We were waiting for the right time, the right place. His spirit was here to minister to us. All of us, we need healing in our spirit, in our body, and all. And it was said, overcome the devil with the word of our testimony. We have to testify. The blood of the Lamb. The blood of the Lamb. The word has been preached. The God says he accompanies. This gets me. He accompanies the preaching of the word with signs and miracles.
That's right.
We've had it today.
That's right.
To preach the word, and I'm a testimony. I'm telling you, man, if you could have heard that popcorn, it's all like popcorn in my neck.
Man, I tell you, people, I guarantee you, not only in the physical healings today, how many guys have been healed spiritually today? Raise your hand.
Oh, yeah. All right.
You was touched spiritually today?
Yeah.
Amazing. That is right there.
Well,
people healed physically, people were healed spiritually.
Right.
You know, how amazing is God? On the very day that, you know, this happens, it's the very time he stands up in the synagogue and reads, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me.
Wow. Right.
It was an appointed, that's right. An appointed reading at an appointed time, because this is the time we're in.
Right.
That's what the feast means. Appointed times and seasons, and that's where we fell.
Wow. Amen.